Hello everybody, in today's lecture we will be talking about good laboratory practices. In general, when you mean good laboratory practices, as the name suggests, these are the practices or these are the good practices that are carried out within a laboratory. And they are essentially a set of principles which are intended to assure the quality and integrity of non-clinical laboratory studies. And they are to support research or marketing which require permits for products that are regulated by the government agencies. So if you need any kind of an approval, or if you need any kind of clearance from a governing body, you should be in a position to convey to the governing body that you have followed those practices which are considered good by that particular governing body. And such good laboratory practices are commonly associated with the pharmaceutical and non-clinical laboratories. And in a few cases, it can also be applied to the non-pharmaceutical laboratories which are involved in the preparation of color additives, food additives, food contamination limits, food packaging, and also medical devices. So here we can say that while the good laboratory practices is mainly applicable on the pharmaceutical and non-clinical laboratories, it will also be an imperative of the food technology and medical biotechnology laboratories to follow such GLP. However, GLP is not applicable for clinical studies. And with the purpose of maintaining the human health and human care during clinical trials, there are what we know as the good clinical practices, and they are entirely different from the good laboratory practices that are prescribed. And therefore, you should always remember that the good laboratory practice or good laboratory practices are unique to non-clinical laboratories, which may be pharmaceutical or biomedical, but not clinical. Furthermore, this GLP is a quality management system and not a scientific management system, because it defines a set of quality standards to conduct an experiment, to conduct a study, to collect data, and also on how to report results. However, it does not give a definition of the scientific standards that are to be followed. It will not necessarily say which reagent you should do or you should use, but it will say how to prepare that reagent or how to store that reagent or how to label that reagent adequately in order to maintain the quality of the laboratory, thereby acting as a quality assurance unit which will help in verifying all the written procedures that are followed throughout the study. So in essence, a good laboratory practice although not scientific, will act as a complementary technique to the scientific procedures followed in order to maintain the quality of the results obtained. And globally, in today's scenario, the good laboratory practices which are followed are put forth by two independent agencies. The first one is the United States Food and Drug Administration, also known as the US FDA, and the regulations put forth by US FDA which highlight the good laboratory practices are referred to as the 21 CFR 58, where CFR stands for Code of Federal Regulations. Nextly, we have the principles of GLP and compliance monitoring, or the principles of good laboratory practice and compliance monitoring, which has been put forth by OECD, or the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, to promote and to urge the laboratories to follow good laboratory practice. And globally, these are the two standard regulations that are applicable and that are followed throughout. Now, talking about the scope of GLP. Within a laboratory system, GLP can be applicable to various components of the laboratory related exercises. There could be an in-house GLP procedure that is supposed to be followed, where the technique or the protocol or the set of practices to be followed are specific to that particular laboratory only, and they have standardized those procedures to that particular laboratory. Nextly, GLP will be used in the investigation of outer specification analysis result, where you have obtained result by conducting some experiment that is out of specification. And there will be a set of rules on how you should investigate and interpret such results. Nextly, GLP guides through the destruction of excess samples that act as leftovers after the analysis. This is an important criteria here. If the sample is precious, care must be taken not to waste the sample and store it for further utilization. But if the sample is in excess, you should look into those aspects of the sample which makes it hazardous. So if it is an hazardous sample, you should follow certain good laboratory practices which will neutralize the sample, or which will aid in proper disposal of the sample by the means of destruction. Next, there are working bench practices that are to be followed. In any laboratory, that portion of the laboratory where the experiment is conducted will be called a working bench. And every researcher should follow clean etiquette in the working bench, where care must be taken to clean the working bench before the start of the exercises or experiments. And once the experiments are conducted, the working bench must be cleaned, and also things must be organized and neatly labeled so that if the researcher discontinues and another person occupies that working bench, he should be in a position to recognize or understand what is what. Nextly, there is disposal of waste generated in the quality control. See, while we are doing quality control, there can be certain wastes that are generated. And how to dispose them is also an important factor to be noted. Then comes the maintenance of laboratory instruments. Laboratory instruments are mostly electronic devices which require attention at regular intervals. This attention might be in the form of calibration or in the form of servicing or simply in the form of cleaning or charging. So all of this is taken care of while good laboratory practices are followed. So here the laboratory instruments are neatly maintained and there is a logbook that is specifically kept in order to keep a track of who is using the instrument and for what duration the instrument is being used and things like that. Then there is event reporting or investigation that is to be followed, where the researcher must report the findings of his experiments to his supervisor. And also, he must file the raw data obtained and neatly write in a book the observations made. Then comes calibration and handling of out of calibration. Whereas I mentioned, calibration is also associated with the maintenance of lab equipment. And calibration is in particular is very, very important, because if an instrument is not appropriately calibrated, it would start showing wrong readings. And in such cases, when an instrument is out of calibration, an immediate calibration must be carried out by an experienced person. Also, sampling procedure of the raw materials is one good laboratory practice that is to be taken care of. Raw materials are resources. Raw materials are important because the laboratory pays for the raw materials and it must be taken care not to waste them. Thereby, sampling of these raw materials is very important, and this is carried out by firstly labeling the raw materials and keeping a track of when the raw materials arrived and where they have to be stored. So if the raw material is volatile, where it has to be stored. If the raw material degrades upon exposure to room temperature, where it has to be stored. If the raw material is an acid, where it has to be stored. If it is a buffer, what is the kind of care to be taken. So all of these procedures for each of the raw materials is again a good laboratory practice. Likewise, sampling of the finished product. And since we are talking about pharmaceutical or non-clinical laboratories, most of the products are drug products. Just like how we are worried about taking care of the raw materials, we must be equally worried about sampling the product obtained upon utilizing these raw materials, because either of them are precious. And in the case of pharmaceutical laboratories, HPLC or the high performance liquid chromatography utilization is very high. And this instrument is very expensive, and care must be taken while using the instrument. So there is a general practice that is followed to clean up the HPLC before and after the experiment, and to take care of the reagents or the solvents used for the purpose of HPLC. Then comes the plant modification system, where suitable planning will be required to modify certain experiments wherever necessary. And also there must be a control over changes that are carried out. Frequent changes are not always advised in a quality assurance laboratory. If frequent changes are carried out, then the quality cannot be assured in the first place. So there is a particular procedure for change control also. And most importantly, training and development is essential. When you have researchers who are recruited frequently or who are in a laboratory on a rotation basis, they must be adequately trained and oriented towards the development of the laboratory. And nextly, if the laboratory is carrying out any contract testing, where it acts as a contractor to receive samples, or it sends out samples on a contract for testing in a different laboratory, there must be a clear procedure followed, and the samples must be neatly transferred without any damage, without any spillage, and also with adequate labeling and entry into the logbooks. And then will be the sampling and acceptance quality level of the packaging material. If the laboratory is giving out a finished product, there is a good amount of interest that is to be put into the packaging material also, because the quality and the constituents of the packaging material will depend on the product that is being manufactured. So if there are any ingredients in the packaging material that could cause harm to the product, or that could change, or that could react with the product, care must be taken to avoid such ingredients. Thereby, there has to be a great deal of effort put into check for the quality of the packaging material where the product goes into. So this is where sampling of the product is highlighted again. And finally, there has to be a frequent internal quality audit that is carried out by authorities of the institute or the laboratory to make sure that everything is in place and everything is being carried out according to the regulations specified. And all such GLPs are usually found listed as standard operating procedures or the SOPs for each of the sections that we just spoke about. Additionally, general lab etiquettes such as wearing of personal protective gear, not eating or drinking inside the lab, etc., are also to be complied to while carrying out GLP. So in general, GLP embodies a set of principles that provides a framework within which laboratory activities are planned, performed, monitored, recorded, reported, and also archived. And this helps assuring the regulatory authorities that the submitted data are true reflection of the results obtained during the study. So this gives a guarantee of no manipulation, and this can therefore be relied upon when making the risk or safety assessment. And in general, good laboratory practices concerns all people who are working within the laboratory, be it the managers, supervisors or staff, who in their own independent capacities are affecting the activities such as maintenance, cleaning, record keeping, etc. within the laboratory. While the GLP is independent to each of these people, depending on the kind of work they are done, there are some basic rules which can be applied uniformly as well. So this is how good laboratory practices are important in maintaining the quality of the results. And this comes with a particular reference to the industrial applications of science. Thank you all.